Lupin Pharmaceuticals in association with Higher Secondary Principals Forum.
Welcome students to a class on the rat trap by Selma Lagaroff. A piece of advice before you watch this presentation, please read the lesson, the rat trap, and then watch this presentation. Thank you. Now, we will go as per the textbook. The textbook has a layout. We will follow the layout. So I have written an agenda in that same manner. It starts with a brief introduction of the author. We will also deal with the significance of the title, The Rat Trap, the theme of the lesson, the role played by the central character, the peddler, his strength and weaknesses, the other characters, the crofter, the Iron Master, and with Edla will mention. And last, we will do the question answers from the Goa board papers. Now, coming to the author, the layout is a brief introduction about the author. What have I done? If I've highlighted on the alphabet O, the two dots, which you can see, Umlaut, you know, it gives you a softer vowel sound in Scandinavian languages. You will find the two dots also in another name in this textbook, which is one of the names of one of the blacksmiths, Stredin Storm. You know, so again, the O has the two dots. Found in Scandinavian languages and seen also here. Basically, Selma Lagerlöf is a Swedish writer, a teacher by profession, and the Swedish university also did tell her to give up her teaching profession because she was such a famous writer that she was the first woman to win the Nobel Prize in Literature for her book, The Wonderful Adventures of Niels. And what we learn about her is she has this underlining theme. The theme, her belief, that goodness in human beings can be awakened through love and understanding. Another interesting fact about the author is this book actually, The Wonderful Adventures of Niels, the one that she got the Nobel Prize in Literature for, is making Swedish geography fun for the children. So the book actually talks about Niels' wonderful journey across Sweden. Now coming back to what we have in the textbook, if you look at the layout of the textbook, it always starts with the rat trap, the name of the lesson, the author. Then you have an introduction about the author. And the other introduction that she gives to the lesson is that it is a kind of a fairy tale. She also is a very proud Swedish personality because she talks about the history and the legend of that particular place, talking about the richness in its iron ore. So the lesson is based around this particular fact. Now, coming back to your textbook, if you have your textbooks, please open it in front of you all. And as I said, whenever you go to class, you always should go prepared to get a more meaningful understanding of the text. Now, it starts with, if you notice, it starts with these expressions in the textbook where you have to infer the meanings from the context. Now, what I want you all to do is very interesting to note. Out of these 9 expressions, you find that 5 of them come in the very beginning of the lesson. So, in the beginning of the lesson, the first 3 paragraphs. Now, what we are going to do is we are going to go, I'll read the beginning, I'll read the end, and then we'll see how we go along with the explanation of the lesson. We'll start. Once upon a time, there was a man who went around selling small rat traps of wire. He made them himself at the odd moments from the material he got by begging in the stores or at the big farms. But even so, the business was not especially profitable. So he had to resort to both begging and petty thievery to keep body and soul together. Even so, his clothes were in rags, his cheeks were sunken, and hunger gleamed in his eyes. I said fairy tale, once upon a time there was a man. So this is exactly what they are trying to tell us here. The narrator here himself, we find a rat trap peddler, a person selling rat traps. They tell us about his life. They say that, again, selling rat traps is not a profitable business. It is not something that it is an essential commodity that everybody would buy. So business was not flourishing for him. And he did not make enough to keep himself alive. He just barely was able to make enough. And how was he able to do that? He would beg or he would steal. Now here, keeping body and soul together, everybody knows now when you say infer the meanings of these expressions from the context, it simply means to stay alive. Hunger gleamed in his eyes. Though we all know that we have to eat to live. That means you have to eat something to survive. And I hope it's not the other way around where you live to eat. Here, we find that in spite of him eating, he was not eating, getting enough to eat to satisfy his hunger. That's why you could see that he was starved. Hunger gleamed in his eyes. Okay, so we'll continue. No one can imagine how sad and monotonous life can appear to such a vagabond who plods along the road left to his own meditations. But one day, this man had fallen into a line of thought which really seemed to him entertaining. He had naturally been thinking of his rat traps when suddenly he was struck by the idea that the whole world about him, the whole world with its lands and seas, its cities and villages, was nothing but a big rat trap. Now, here, you see, what we understand is this person, they're talking about how sad and monotonous his life can appear for a vagabond. Vagabond is one person who goes from one place to the other, does not have a home, walking, because they say plods along the road. Here, plods refer to slow, heavy walking. Left to his own meditations, thinking about himself, about his life, when suddenly he comes into this idea, and this one idea resulted into a series of thoughts. Now, he was thinking automatically, obviously about his rat traps, because he was selling his rat traps. He realizes and he makes this connection that the whole world is a rat trap. Now, how does he say that? What connection did he make? Fallen into a line of thought, coming into a series of thoughts, thinking seriously. As I said, vagabond, if you look at the picture again, you find the peddler selling rat traps. You find him moving from one place to the other, and he's not able to make much. Continue with the text. It had never existed for any other purpose than to set baits for people. It offered riches and joys, shelter and food, heat and clothing, exactly as the rat trap offered cheese and pork. And as soon as someone let himself be tempted to touch the bait, it closed in on him and then everything came to an end. Now, the metaphor continues. In the very beginning I said, he has compared the world to a rat trap. Now he's saying, just as the rat trap offers bait, and the bait in question here, they say cheese and pork to catch rats, the bait used by the world is riches, joy, shelter, food, clothing. They're talking about getting more money, better standard of living. So they say, the moment people run after these things, they get trapped and it's the end of their life. It leads to destruction. And this is what we understand the meaning of the world being compared to a rat trap. As I said, we are going to go with the layout of the textbook. The very first question when we read now, the first question that we read, it appears on question on page 29. The question is, from where did the peddler get the idea that the world is a rat trap? The world being a trap. Obviously, everybody knows the answer. It is falling into his own thoughts, no? During one of his dreary ploddings, that he comes up with the idea that the world is a big rat trap because he was thinking of nothing else but his traps. The other thing that you could ask, and please remember the Goa board expects you to answer these questions in 25 to 30 words. So what they expect you to do. Now if I ask you another question, and I'm sure all of you all will be able to get the answer. What was the peddler's philosophy about his rat traps? This philosophy, that the world is compared to a rat trap and it offers several baits, and the moment people are tempted to touch the bait, it closes on him and everything comes to an end. Now, we'll continue with the text. As I said, you're going to get the meanings of the expressions as you read the text. The world had, of course, never been kind to him, so it gave him unwanted joy to think ill of it in this way. it became a cherished pastime of his during many dreary ploddings to think of people he knew who had let themselves be caught in the dangerous snare and of the others who were still circling round the bait. Now, unwanted joy refers to unaccustomed, it refers to unusual. Now, in this context, what it means that he was not accustomed to experiencing such joy. And what joy? To think ill about the world. To think that the world was not a good place. Why? Because everybody was like that. Nobody was kind to him. He was never given anything by people. He had to resort to begging. He had to resort to robbing small things, petty thievery. So he did not like because people were not good to him. So he says, what gave him happiness? To think that people are running after something and getting caught, and the similarity is his rat trap is very much similar to the world, catching people, trapping people. And in spite of knowing that you are going to be tempted by the bait, you still run after it and get trapped. So it doesn't happen once, it happens repeatedly. Now we'll just have a recap of inferring the meanings from the text. Infer the meanings from the context. Keep body and soul together. Keep oneself alive. Hunger gleamed in his eyes. He was starved. Plods along the road. A slow, heavy walk. Fallen into a line of thought. Involved in a series of thoughts. Unwanted joy refers to unaccustomed, unusual. It refers to joy that he was not accustomed to experiencing. Now, as we said, you are already familiar now with the central character. The protagonist is the rat trap peddler. And the story revolves around this peddler. The story will provide us an insight on human nature. And as we said, it also talks about the metaphor in today's context. Now, what is the metaphor? I already told you that the world is a big rat trap. Now, we must remember that whenever we are studying, and learning is a never-ending process, learning for you, learning for me, learning for everybody, we will be able to understand what values do we get. It has to go beyond classroom teaching. You're not here just to answer your exams, but you're here to do well, you're here to evolve as individuals, you're here, me included, to become better individuals. And I think this particular metaphor, the world being a rat trap, teaches us much more than what we have to be prepared for. Now, the characters that will go around this story will involve the peddler being associated with a number of people. The people that he meets also is a crofter. A crofter, basically a farmer who has the tenancy of land. He is not the owner. And we also come to know the iron master, who is the owner of a famous iron mill, Ramjo's Iron Mill. And as I said, the author tried to bring out the story talking about the ironworks, which is the history and the legend, one of the important things in Sweden. We are going to learn about the kinds of bait and how people are trapped. Now, as I said, the central character, we started with the reading of the lesson. The reading of the lesson, which started talking about a peddler, a vagabond, a thief, a beggar, you know, he trying to sell his rat traps, not being able to make enough money, and left to his own meditation. They said, you can't imagine how sad and monotonous life can appear for a vagabond. I mean, you can't imagine. That means their life is sheer nothing but misery. Their life is filled with unhappiness. So he says, obviously, left to his own meditation, he does not have friends, nobody to talk to. That's the time he came up with this idea that the world was a big rat trap. So actually, to think about it, he has come out with a great idea. Now, as we said, a peddler is a person who goes from one place to the other. The first person that he meets is a crofter. As I already said, a crofter is a farmer, basically a farmer. Now, walking along the road, they give us another feature. He knocks at a grey cottage. And Why does he knock at the gray at a cottage? Because he does not want to sleep outside. Now, why he doesn't want to sleep on the roadside or in the open? Because he could possibly freeze to death or possibly robbed or, you know, get hurt. So what he would do is, on a regular basis, during the nights, he would try to take shelter either in somebody's place or anywhere else where he would be able to keep his head himself under some kind of protection. So the first house that he knocked was an old man's house who was a crofter earlier, because they say he worked during his younger days at a farm at Ramjo's. But now, older man, unable to do farm work. Interesting fact about him was that he had a cow, and the name of his cow was Bossy. Now, he was able to get enough for himself because he would milk the cow every day and sell the milk to the creamery. Now, when this peddler knocks at his door, we find for the first time, the peddler also acknowledges, he says, normally people would chase me away. But this time, the old man, a lonely old man, very happy to have company, allows the peddler into his home, gives him porridge, gives him a big chunk of tobacco, starts playing cards with him, and going to the extent of, there's a line, he was just as generous of all his things, including porridge and tobacco, of his confidences. Now, what did he do? Normally, I would repeat, normally when we have a stranger in the house, we are not going to tell him everything. But this old man went to that extreme end of feeding him, playing cards with him, and continuously started talking about his life. And I have used a line which appears in this, a lonely, generous, hospitable, friendly man. Now, I've used a line from the text, the stranger must have seemed incredulous. Now, who is the stranger in question here? Is the peddler. Why? Incredulous means unable to believe. Now what happened here was, when the crofter was explaining to him, I have a cow, her name is Bossy, I would milk her every day and sell the milk to a creamery. And latest was, I got 30 kroners for the milk. The stranger seemed incredulous, here unable to believe. 30 kroners, kroners is the currency in Sweden. What happened was, he suddenly realizes that that according to the crofter, he says, the peddler did not believe me, the stranger did not believe me. Now, the curious part about the story is, this crofter decides to tell him and actually show him the money. Now, there is a very common this thing where we say, never tempt providence. This is exactly what happened to him a little later. What happened to him was a tragedy. He shows the 30 kroner bills. He goes towards a window. On the side of the window, it's a glass pane. On the side of the window frame, there is a leather pouch. He takes out the leather pouch in front of the stranger, opens the leather pouch, takes out the 3 wrinkled notes and actually dangles it in front of the stranger's eyes. Puts the money back into the leather pouch and hangs it in on the window frame again. What do you think will happen? As I said, never tempt providence. Both of them go to sleep. The next morning, obviously, the crofter has to leave because he's not his friend or anything. And the peddler has to leave. The crofter also has to leave early in the morning and go out because he has to milk his cow. And so both of them come out of the house. The crofter locks the door, puts the key into his pocket. The peddler says thank you and leaves. Within 2 minutes, the peddler returns back in front of the house of this crofter. What do you think he did? He smashes the glass pane, puts his hand through the window, takes out the leather pouch, takes out the money, puts it into his pocket, takes the empty leather pouch and hangs it back where it was and leaves. Now, when he leaves, he says, a rat trap peddler leaving with stolen money in his pocket. I'm not going to be seen on the road, so I might as well go into the forest region. So he decides to step into the forest. Now he compares the forest to a trap because something happens to him. He says, impenetrable prison with no escape. He was just roaming around in circles to such an extent that he was completely exhausted and tired. There was no escape when he realizes that he had been trapped. Now, when he realizes he was trapped, losing all strength, energy, it was raining very heavily, end of December, Christmas time, he was totally drenched, hungry. Something happens to him. He falls to the floor. When he falls to the floor, he hears a regular thumping sound. Thumping sound? This regular hammer sound of an iron mill, you know. Then he realizes that there are some blacksmiths around the place. He says, nothing doing. I'm going to find my way to this iron mill and I'm going to stay there for the night instead of freezing to death outside. So he manages to find his way to this iron mill. Now, as I said, what the author was trying to do is highlight the history of Sweden, which is rich in its iron ore. This is what she was trying to tell us. Now, what we are given to understand what happened at Ramjo's ironwork was there were the blacksmiths working. They tell us also earlier, the owner of this Ramjo's ironworks was a very rich man, the iron master. He was a very proud person. He was one who made sure that the whatever material went out from his factory was quality material. So he believed in making sure that everything was done well in his factory, in his iron mill. Now, but they tell us that during the time of December, the factory was closed, but part of it was working because you see the blacksmiths working there, you know, one trying to bang the pig iron on the anvil, and you have the use of the fire boy. Very interesting to say that one who has to look after the fire, the one who uses charcoal to put it into the furnace to make sure that the fire is completely, is continuously burning. And blacksmiths are doing their work. This person suddenly decides to enter the forge and he finds that it's very warm. And he tries to get the attention of the people working in the forge, but they don't even bother. That's why I used the line from the text. Master blacksmith nodded a haughty consent without honoring him with a single word. Now, when you're entering in the iron mills, obviously he sees somebody. That person doesn't even bother. And he decides to lie down. He wants to lie down. Again, another curious fact about this peddler is when he's sleeping, he lies down with his eyes open, you know. He's actually taking rest because they tell us this incident in the later part of the textbook. You will find that he has his hat over his face when he's taking rest. Now, the blacksmiths are doing their work. They are not bothered about who enters the forge because it's not theirs. But the habit of the iron master, the owner of the mill, had always had this feature where he would have nightly routine inspections, because in the night normally people don't do their work properly, and he wanted work done well. So when he was during his nightly routine, he comes there, he finds this man sleeping on the floor, this peddler, this stranger, this beggar. He finds him sleeping on the floor with his hat on his face. He reacts exactly in the opposite manner as compared to what the blacksmith did. The blacksmith didn't bother about the stranger entering. The owner, what does he do? He sees very clearly. He goes towards the peddler who is lying down, throws off his hat and looks at him. At that time, the peddler is startled and he jumps up. It appears as if during the night time, the Iron Master recognizes the peddler. He says, and I've quoted the words from the text, "It is you, Niels Olof," he said. So he recognizes him and he continues to talk about him as this old regimental comrade, Captain Vonstad. Now, according to him, the Iron Master, he was also in the army, in the military, because he says, "I left and then you must have left. I did not know that you left." So he says, "And if I knew that you were going to leave, I wouldn't have allowed you to. But I did not know anything about what you did with your life because I left the regiment much earlier." So he recognizes him as Captain Vonstad. He says, "You, my great friend, Captain Vonstad, it's great to see you." And something happens there. The Iron Master invites him to his home. What does he say? He says, "Please, come to my home. Come to my place. It is not a very fine home, so don't be embarrassed because you're a poor man. I do not have a wife. My sons are abroad, and I have only my daughter. But I want you to come home because it's Christmas. Let's make the Christmas meal disappear." So now, what do we understand now? Getting a chance to actually go and stay in this beautiful house owned by the Iron Master is going to be much more comfortable than lying on the floor. But we realize that the peddler is a very smart guy. He says, "Going up to the manor house is like throwing oneself into the lion's den." Now, what is the meaning of that? Caught red-handed. To be eaten alive, actually it means. Why is he going to be eaten alive? It's because he has the stolen money in his pocket. So he says, "Definitely no, I'm very comfortable here. I'm going to sleep." The story doesn't end there. He decides to go back home and tell his daughter. Now, his daughter, Edla will mention, exceptionally kind, generous, very, very sharp, observant, greater powers of persuasion. Now, what does he do? The father decides to tell his daughter back home, "Please go to the ironworks and I have my comrade friend there, Captain Vonstad. I think things have gone downhill for him. Why don't we bring him home? He has refused to listen to me. Your powers of persuasion is much more than mine. I'm sure you can convince the poor man to come to our place." Now, this is what the father tells the girl. So the girl takes help. She takes a valet, she takes a coat, and she goes into the iron works. Now, another thing I told you all about the Amlat, the two dots on the surname of the author. You also have another name of a blacksmith, Strengthstorm. You will find the two dots also on the alphabet, or the softer vowel sound. I hope I'm getting it correct. Now, what happens when Edla Will Mansion decides to go to the ironworks? She sees the man there. He's lying on the floor. She goes up to him. And the very first look when she sees him, she realizes that this person, because of the fear that she sees on this man's face, this person had either escaped from jail or had stolen something. She even doubted whether this man could have ever had an education, because being in the regimental comrade, being in the regiment, I'm sure nobody could have fallen to such an extent where he resorts to begging and petty thievery. So we find that Edla Will Mansion is actually a very observant person. At the same time, she, as I said, she has a greater powers of persuasion because she manages to convince her father also afterwards. We'll learn about that story. But she manages to convince the peddler to come home with one sheer statement that she makes. And she says, "You can leave as freely as you have come. Now, why did the peddler decide to agree to that? Is because he realizes that this is not a trap, that he can leave as soon as he wants, that there is nothing, nobody wants anything from him. It's just that they want him to have supper. It's Christmas Eve. They want to spread this happiness. So they decide to get him to have a proper meal, and then he can go wherever he wants to. She was so convincing, so kind, that the peddler decides to go with Edla, with the daughter. He goes home to the manor house. Next day in the morning, the servants bathe him, they shave him, they put on clean clothes, and he comes in front of the iron master. At that time, the iron master is furiated. Furiated because he has realized the mistake he has made. And what is the mistake? The mistake that he has made is, this man is not my friend. This man is not Captain Wonstar. This man is not from the regiment. He gets so very angry that he starts being so abusive and decides to call the cops. At that time, we find the peddler comes out with his metaphor of the world being a big rat trap. If you read the text, you will find that he is not totally to be blamed, because the peddler not once, twice, thrice told the iron master that he was comfortable where he was, that he has no interest in coming to the manor house, that he does not want anything from them. But they insisted, saying that they wanted him to come and have lunch, share the Christmas meal. So he bangs his hand on the table and he starts telling him, see, these things can happen to anybody. I'm telling you what happened to me. I got tempted by what you offered, and it can happen to you too. Mistakes can happen. It appears as if the Iron Master was enlightened by the idea of the world being a rat trap and the bait offered, and people can get tempted and can get trapped. So he decides, okay, you do one thing. Put on your dirty clothes and leave the place. Now, what do we see about this girl, the daughter, the Iron Master's daughter? It is very important to note that she was genuinely a kind person. Now, today when somebody is simply kind, we would never believe it. Why? Because there are always ulterior motives. If somebody wants to do something for us, they say, okay, what do I have to do? So exactly the same thing happened to the peddler. The peddler did not know why the girl decided to intercede for this stranger, knowing that he was not her father's friend. She convinces the father, saying, Father, let this poor man stay. We've already promised him Christmas cheer. Let him have the food and leave. Now, as we said, that the daughter had greater powers of persuasion, able to convince the peddler, she manages also to convince the father. So the man stayed the night. Not over. See the way in which her kindness is seen. Sometimes people say, oh, come over for lunch, but they don't mean it. Here, this woman, the daughter, Edla will mention, takes the beggar by his hand, makes him sit at the table and says, please eat. So he knew that he was expected to eat and that they didn't want anything else. They just wanted to share their meal. So he eats, sleeps. He does the whole thing. He does that the whole day. Eats, sleeps. Now, what happened when he slept? As I said, it was Christmas Eve. The following morning, we find the Iron Master and his daughter go to church. Christmas Eve, they are in church. And you know how in villages, news spreads like wildfire. While she was detected, while she was leaving home, totally sad and upset is because at the church, they were informed that a rat trap peddler had stolen money from a crofter. So now, coming home back in their ride, the father was giving a mouthful to the girl, saying, "Your idea of allowing the peddler to stay for the night, your great idea of trying to be kind to a total stranger. Now, what do you think will happen when we go home?" Obviously, they are thinking that their house is going to be robbed. As soon as they reach home, the guard tells them that the peddler has left, but he has kept something back for the daughter. Now, very interesting fact. The ending, returning back from the church, they've already come home, and the person at home tells them that there is a gift for you. She goes running, opens the gift. The gift is hardly wrapped properly, and she sees a rat trap, a note, and inside the rat trap were the three wrinkled Cronin bills. So you can imagine what must have gone through the mind of this girl. Her genuine kindness has done something to this man. Now, what did the letter indicate? See the way in which he explains himself. It's a beautiful ending of the story, the climax of the story. See, honored and noble miss, since you have been so nice to me all day, as if I was a captain, I want to be nice to you in return, as if I was a real captain. For I do not want you to be embarrassed at this Christmas season by a thief. But you can give back the money to the old man on the roadside who had the money pouch hanging on the window frame as a bait for poor wanderers. The rat trap is a Christmas present from a rat who had been caught in this world's rat trap if he had not been raised to captain, because in that way he got the power to clear himself. Written with friendship and high regard, Captain Von Stahl. Now, do you think the peddler was Captain Von Stahl? You can imagine the extent of her happiness. This one positive figure was able to change the ways of a poor man, a thief. And what else he says? He says, "I would not want you to be embarrassed by a thief. So I'm going to do a very noble thing." The noble thing was to return the stolen money. And the rat trap is a present from a rat. We are all rats running after things. See, the humor actually is quite a witty person. And he says, "You have been so kind enough that I have decided to sign myself as Captain Von Stahl, as if I was really a captain." So here, the ending of the story talks about the peddler. The peddler who is actually transformed, becoming totally a different human being, transformed from a thief to returning the money. And see the way he understands the bait used by the old man, the crofter. He says, "He uses it as a bait to trap me." Don't you think that he would have known that the money was taken by the rat trap peddler? Because the money was missing, the window pane was broken, the money pouch was back on the nail. So obviously he would know. So this is what he's saying. This old man, though he was kind, hospitable, he was a lonely man, because we know that there's another thing that we learn about human nature is no one likes to stay alone. So having company for the night was something that he wanted. So he played cards with him. He had his way, but it came at a cost. He tried to tempt his fellow. This person did get tempted and he robbed him. So here, The daughter, the Iron Master's daughter, gave him a chance to redeem himself, gave him a chance to clear his name, gave him a chance to sign himself as Captain One Star. Now, as I said, the conclusion of the story refers to the victory of human nature. The theme, a belief that essential goodness in human being can be awakened through love and understanding. This is what the author was trying to tell us in the very beginning, that basically it's good to know that we should think what she's trying to say much more than what is just given, that basically we are all good people. So maybe we can try to spread this love and understanding, and what trying times that we are here during the pandemic, to try to spread this love and understanding amongst others, and automatically it will, you know, spread amongst the others, and the world could become a better place. Here we find the conclusion again. The peddler leaves, not taking anything from the home, but giving back something that he had taken from the others. Got a chance to redeem himself, got the power to redeem himself. Now, this girl was genuinely kind. As we said, it is very difficult to understand why some people are simply kind. Now, if you decide to do something for somebody, just like that, without even knowing, they, you know, they're always doubtful. So this is what we see in the lesson also. The peddler just could not understand, why is this girl interceding for him over and over again? The father said, leave my home. But she says, no, stay for the night. Not only that, takes him by the hand and tells him to have supper, allows him to sleep, and continues with her request, saying that anytime he just wants to sleep without being troubled, a day of peace, he was welcomed back into their home. So she was simply a very kind person. So that was the ending of the story. So you see how the kindness of this person has been transmitted through the daughter, and this man also is able to change his ways. Now, as I said earlier, when you're reading the textbook, you will find that there are questions at the side of the text, of the lesson. These questions appear where they say, think as you read. And we did mention the very first one, where did the peddler get the idea of the world being a rat trap? Now, again, board exam, they expect you to answer. Prose section under Flamingo textbook, you are supposed to answer the questions where you have to answer between 25 to 30 words. Those are 2-mark questions. Now, the other section, again, they have different kinds of questions, but I'm talking about the lesson here. In question is the rat trap. Now, if you just take an example of a question, how does the metaphor of the rat trap seem to serve to highlight human predicament? Very important to understand that people are trapped. How? The world compared to a trap which sets bait to lure people in. Once they are trapped, it's the end. And yet, people circle around the bait knowing the dangers. So this is what we understand. If you know that you're going to be trapped because there is something tempting, why are we doing it? That is human predicament, which we understand. Now, take another question, last year's paper, March 2020. How did the Iron Master convince the peddler to accompany him to the manor house? Now, if you read the textbook, it's very important that you read the textbook. I said read to understand and not to memorize. You will be able to understand the entire textbook and able to answer the questions. Now, in the text, they have told us, there are lines there, that he does not have a fine home, that his wife was dead, his children were abroad, his sons were abroad, and there was nobody at home except his daughter. And you can also, they also mention about he wanting, inviting him to share in the Christmas meal. The other question that you can talk about in this particular text, there are quite a number of questions in this text, but we will talk about the questions appearing in the Goa board. Noticing here, what doubts did Edla have about the peddler? It appeared in March 2019. Noticing the fear on the peddler's face, Edla doubts that he was either a thief or that had escaped from jail. She doubts that he has ever been educated. You can write any 2 points. Now, looking at your answer has to be written between 25 and 30 words. The next question, appearing in March 2013. Why did Edla still entertain the peddler even after she knew the truth about him? Now, everybody knows the answer to that. They had promised the peddler Christmas cheer to share the supper. She wanted him to enjoy a day of peace as his life was so full of hardships. In the very beginning, we are told, no one can imagine how sad and monotonous the life of a peddler can be. This is exactly that. Sad and monotonous, so full of hardships. It is because it was something that he was doing every day, just selling rat traps. His business was not profitable. What was he doing eventually? Robbing, begging. It was a miserable life that he was leading. So she just wanted to help this poor man. So it is a fact that people are simply kind. Now, it is, as I said, we have come to the end of the presentation. If you remember, we had told you to open your textbooks. I have taken questions from the Goa board papers, and we had discussed, if you remember, the plot of the story, which revolves around getting an insight to human nature, the metaphor used in today's context, the different characters that have used a greed for material things, which is very common, which everybody finds, the kind of baits used, and how people are trapped. So it's important you read the text, read to understand, not to memorize. You'll be able to answer the questions that follow. We have discussed the Goa board questions, and it's important that you follow the pattern of answering the questions between 25 to 30 words. Thank you. Stay safe.
Prudent Scholars, powered by Lupin Pharmaceuticals.